economy.
Well, that has been our argument since 1994 when we started this process, that ours is to have a flexible, regulated labor regime that is able to protect workers against exploitation, that is flexible enough for business to be able to do business. Mm. And that has been our regime over these years. And the fact that...
Do you think we're too rigid right now?
We don't think so. I mean, if we were too rigid, I mean, normally many employers say that the labor laws are too rigid, we cannot dismiss. During the recession in 2008, 1 million workers were dismissed in this country. If million workers could be dismissed, what makes it rigid? Yeah. Now, if you go to the CCMA, the number of cases of workers that are dismissed, our labor legislation is simple. There's no requirement to have a formal hearing. You must give a hearing. You don't have to create a court process in the company. You've got to indicate, give a notice, have a hearing, and put the case and let the worker defend themselves. Therefore, we don't see any rigidity in the labor.
So that's the one side. On the other side, are you sad? I mean, we looked at whether 3,500 rand can feed a family of three the other day, and it cannot. You have people who are still working just to be able to get enough to eat, just to be able to continue to work. It's subsistence living.
I agree. I mean, the fact of the matter that we need to look at is that in this country presently, there's about 4.6 million workers who earn far below the 20 rand that we're talking about. Mm. Workers in the hairdressing industry, when you go to your saloon to do your hair, when I go and cut my hair, those workers earn around about 10, 11 rand an hour. Mm. Now, with the 20 rand, it's going to increase almost double their wages. Now, when we decide on what the level is, it's not the amount that we've just taken out of the air. We have to consider what are the effects. Remember that it doesn't make sense to legislate 12,500 for workers and then 50% of your workers lose their job. Mm. The workers who are unemployed are more vulnerable than workers who are employed. We're not saying that any amount is good enough. But what he's saying, this is a start. And if, after implementing the national minimum wage, there are no negative effect on jobs, if the negative effect are minimum on jobs, going forward, there will be scope and space to increase the minimum wage as you go forward. But we've got to be careful that we don't introduce a minimum wage and take people out of employment.
So what would you say to that person you're talking to who's earning 11 rand an hour, should be earning 20 rand an hour, because that's been agreed upon? Why is this not being introduced tomorrow as planned?
Well, I mean, remember, before any law is introduced, Parliament has got to follow all its processes. If Parliament does not follow its processes and do the right thing, those people who do not want the minimum wage will take Parliament to court. And if they take Parliament to court and the Parliament lose the case on the basis of the processes that were rushed, nobody benefits in that. Therefore, for us, we want to make sure that we do everything that we need to do right, correctly, so that even if somebody takes us to court, we are able to defend the national minimum wage.
So there are some other changes expected to come in. The one will make it harder to strike. The unions will have to go and ballot their workers. You've been accused of trying to dampen workers' rights indirectly, make it hard, make it expensive to strike.
Well, the first thing that we need to raise is that unions were one of the organizations that fought for democracy in this country over many years. And the issue of ballot is a democratic principle. That's the first thing. The second thing is that the present law already requires that a union constitution must have a process of ballot, that union must ballot before they go to strike. It's not an amendment. That's what the law, as we speak now, says.
So why are we changing the law?
The only change that we are making is we are explaining what a ballot is. What has happened over the years is that unions say they've balloted by a show of hands. They'll call workers in the room and workers will raise their head.
Yeah.
The only change that we're making, we're saying a ballot, if you look in the dictionary, Oxford Dictionary, you look for the word ballot, it presupposes that a ballot is secret. It's go hand in hand with secrecy and the ballot paper and fairness. And that's what we're doing. We're explaining that a secret ballot must be secret.
And are you able to police this anyway?
Well, I mean, the way the law is written...
This involves audits to ensure the balloting was secret, fair, huge amounts of workers across the whole economy.
Not necessarily. Remember, the law also allows unions to do the ballot by electronical means. Therefore, a majority of workers in this country have got cell phones, they've got access to cell phones, therefore you can electronically ballot through that process. Mm. And the law requires that the union must keep on the records. And it's only when the register check those records that you'll be able to check whether the ballot was done properly.
Final contentious issues, if we're talking about the laws coming in while I have you. The union's also saying this whole idea that the CCMA will be able to step in if there's violence if in certain industrial actions and make decisions and workers have to stick to that. People are saying that you're trying to take away the rights of workers. And in fact, I was interested in the Mail and Guardian saying today that their stats that show that most of our strikes are actually pretty peaceful. There hasn't been a huge increase, and often there's a resolution after 2 weeks or so.
Yeah, but the issue is this, I mean, the article that we're talking about, it says most of our strikes are peaceful. One death during industrial action is deaths too many. That's the first thing. Mm. Violence and intimidation and death have got no place to play in collective bargaining.
But why don't the cops come in? Why does the CCMA get the right to then come in and say this is how we resolve the strike?
But that's what we're proposing. We're saying that if the strike become violent and or protracted, then the CCMA or the minister should be able to ask that an arbitration should take place. Let an arbitrator give an advice to the parties. Look at this strike now taking place, a bus strike. If we have this legislation now, would be able to ask the CCMA to give an advisory arbitration. It doesn't force the parties to accept it, but it will show whether the employers, when looking at their books, can afford what the unions are asking. It will show whether the employers cannot afford it, and the arbitrator will say, this is what is affordable. Mm. Presently, you don't have that.
Do you think workers finally in South Africa are better off now than they were in 1994?
Definitely, no doubt about that. Workers are better off in terms of protection. Workers are better off in terms of, as I've said, that the wages of workers over the years, the real wages, have gone up. But we are not where we're supposed to be. Still a long road for us, but you can never compare what workers had before 1994 and now.
All right, thank you so much for being with us. That was Temenkosi Mkhalipi from the Department of Labor. Well.